My discussion with you is about work and working. I hope I can achieve three or four purposes. Well, number one, that I can convince you that working is not a curse. That is not the thing you do. What else could I do? How do I educate my children? That it is something good to do, something you do want to do. Number two, I want to encourage you to see that work cannot be done by individuals. It's always done in teams. And that when you don't know how to work in teams, you three problems: you will not enjoy the work, you will not be good at your work, and you are likely to be chucked out of the work if you can't work with people. And I hope I'll be able to achieve that in my discussion. And then finally, related with it, is the hope that I can motivate you not to just put in the day's hours, because what matters are not the hours, it's the work you put in the hours. That is quite a big chunk. And I don't want to keep you here, because I know even if the headmaster allows me to talk to you, you can switch me off. Just be looking at me, but you're actually somewhere else. So, and I'm sure you're a teacher, so you know students can do that. So I will not take forever, even as I discuss that. So let me start at the issue of talking about good teams. A few things that make good teams. I'm aware that I'm talking about three teams: the kindergarten team, the primary school team, and what's the other one called? High school or secondary? Secondary, okay. I don't know the difference. So there are three different teams, but overall you are supposed to be one team. I don't think I have enough time to be able to achieve bringing the three teams into one team. And so I'll not spend a lot of my time on that, although that's also very important. But if you want to be a good team player, the first prerequisite is for you to establish your life's mission. Why were you created? Why are you alive? Until you can establish your life's purpose, your life's mission, it will be very difficult for you to work in a good team or to be a good team player. And there are people here who happen to be teachers because the placement office placed you into the Faculty of Education of your university. So if you ask why are you a teacher, they picked me. Now, and there can be quite a problem if you're a teacher because they made a mistake of picking you and putting you in the Faculty of Education. It will be very difficult for you to be a good player, because you are not a bad worker, but you are still looking forward to going to where you want to work. Here, you are simply growing. Are you getting the point? You know, sometimes you tell a child to do something, you know, to get older. You get the point? Now, so you can find a teacher who has taught for 20 years, but he still has no intention of becoming a teacher. And when you have somebody like that, rest assured, they will find it very difficult. Because there's somebody else who looks like he owns a school, and you wonder what's wrong with them. For you, you are writing letters, and so far you have been writing so many, you can create a book of letters applying elsewhere, not to be a teacher. So I thought the first thing we need to establish is whether your life's purpose has anything to do with the teaching. And I'm not asking you to resign now, but I'm encouraging you to resign soon. Now, I know the headmaster will not like me for this, but it's not fair. Life cannot be lived twice. You are not on a rehearsal. You know, when people are getting married, the pastor calls them a day earlier on a Friday to rehearse. This life is not a rehearsal. You are living it, and you'll never live it again. Are we together? You'll never, ever have the opening day of this time. term or this semester, whatever you call it, again. You will never hear me again like the way you are hearing me. Why? The next time I'm invited to talk, you will know I'm Mr. Nganga, you will know what you expect of me. Am I right? So it will never be the same. Things are not repeated in life. And that's why it's important to establish whether what you are doing is what you should be doing. I still remember the first time I came to Nairobi in 1967. I was just finishing my primary school, and as a treat for the those days, there was no class 8. We used to do KPE at standard 7. So we are finishing. So the headmaster from my rural primary school brought us to the showground, Nairobi showground. Those days used to be called the Royal Show because of the Queen. Now, when we came, I found something very interesting. That after you show your ticket, you go in, there's something that allows you to go in. If you leave your friend outside and you're inside, he said, no, let's first of all see something. You can't go back. You ask them, how can I go? They say, you go to gate B on the other side and you can meet your friend. Have you ever gone through that? That it allows you in, cannot allow you back. That is life. It's one-way traffic. You nod and you can't change direction until you reach the roundabout. Am I communicating? So you need to understand that if you really are going to enjoy your working life, you must seek to be within your life's calling. Because life is unforgiving. Life cannot be repeated. You know, for example, since some of you are teaching high school, maybe in form two or the second year of high school, students have to make a choice. Then the biology teacher is not very liked by some people. So they decide, I will not do biology. If Mr. Nganga is one teaching, I'm not doing biology. So they put to another, to something where they like the teacher. Then in form five, they decide they want to become doctors. So they say they want, and they are told to be a doctor, you must do biology. But they think there's a way out. So they can't do biology, but they do some other sciences. Finally, they apply for university. Is there any way they can become doctors? You know, sometimes I find life very unfair. This form two boy is so young, he can't make a decision. Yet the decision he made without knowing what he was doing is going to lock him out. Unless he agrees to be a form two again. Are you getting the point? That's how unforgiving life is. It doesn't say, but you are young. Even if you are young, it's too late. Of course, it's the same thing with your marriage. You marry the guy, then he has turned out bigger than you expected, but he is still your husband. And if you try to change it, there will be consequences. You don't just drop. You know, some people, and that's not my subject today, but some things people think you can divorce. You can't. Even if you divorce him, he is still your husband. And the next one, you compare with the first, and you always tell them, they are not as good as the first. So by marrying him, your life is spoiled forever. Not for a short time, because everybody will always be compared by the first. So you need to understand life. It's not that you just make a decision, then you can change it. Life doesn't allow you. And so I thought, as I come, I want to encourage you to think clearly whether teaching is what is your life's mission. I don't have a lot of time to spend, but I've written a book on professionals, and I keep saying the most important decision a professional will make is discovering their life's purpose. Why were you created? Why were you born? One way of discovering why you are born is simply thinking, by the time I'm 80, what will I have accomplished? What are the things you look forward to accomplishing? So the exercise I normally encourage people to have is what I call the 80th birthday party. In other words, picture yourself, God has been good to you, you have lived until you are over 80, and then there is a birthday party, you are birthday party. But the people speaking are not allowed to speak, to read their own speeches. You write their speech now that will be read on your 80th birthday. Now, the reason it's good to write it now is because it will help you to think clearly, who am I, what do I hope to accomplish? You know, for example, maybe you are writing a speech that will be read by your spouse, assuming both of you are alive by the age of 8. 8 is not very young. So you write there, oh, our birthday party today is of my darling spouse. And I want to just tell you what he has meant to me after 50 years of marriage, 55, whatever. Now write on that paper exactly the things, the kind of impact you will make on your spouse. And of course, you may not even be married now. You are talking about what you hope to accomplish. It will force you to think ahead of the kind of things, impacts that you hope to make. Another speech will be read by your son. You may not be married now, but assume, let's not say son, let's say child, because we are not sure whether you'll get the child or daughter or son. But remember, the guy is over 50. Your son is over 50. So if you write a speech that's not true, he will not agree to read it, because he can't lie. He's also a grandfather, when you're a great grandfather. So it is that exercise will help you to start answering the question. Is what you are doing today likely to help you to have made the kind of impact that you are seeing in your 80th birthday? Another way of looking at the same subject is to ask yourself, what annoys you? The things that annoy you in life are likely to suggest your purpose for living. You know, some of us, if you see a baby cry, you can't do anything. You have to run to where the baby is. Somehow, you feel like even if you are not the mother, you may not even have a child of your own, but it touches you whenever you hear a child crying. Anything that annoys you, anything that touches you, and you can't explain why, is likely to suggest your area of calling. There are people who are touched by sick people. They really would like to handle the issue of sickness. So whenever they see somebody in pain, it touches them. And they want to change the thing so that the people are not in pain. It might suggest to you that your area of calling is to alleviate physical suffering. But some people just hate poverty. They may not be very rich themselves, but they really hate the idea of people who are poor, poorer than them. And sometimes they live a frustrated life because of that. Of course, sometimes when you don't tackle it properly, it can be a problem. As you remember, when I was at Alliance, when we were in A-level, my classmate just committed suicide, and he left us a suicide note. And the note was called The Tale of Two Cities, Madare and Mudhaiga. And it was very poetic, explaining how the Mudhaiga lives next to Madare and the difference between them. And he says, who in his right mind, so the poem said, can live seeing such a difference and be unable to solve it until it exists? He decided to hang himself. Now, you need to understand that was the wrong direction. But the guy had an interest in helping the poor. So you need to ask yourself, what is it that you feel you are created to solve? Every one of us was created to solve a problem. The only question is, which problem? My guess is, teachers' interest is, they hate ignorant people. When you hear somebody talking ignorantly, you feel like, sure, I wish I could help him. That is what people who are called to teaching are called to deal with: ignorance. And you really enjoy when you are given a child. And I still remember, I'm in my mid-60s, so my children are all above 30 now, but I still remember when they were young, and I tried to get my daughter to say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I'm trying to do the same with my grandchild, but my grandchild has been to be better than my daughter. Now, I would go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. When I reach 10, she has forgotten 1, 2, 3, 5. Now, and then I tried ABCD. And by the time you go X, Y, she has forgotten D, E now. I said, how do the teachers do it? The day my daughter went to kindergarten, by Friday, they were saying all of them. Said, what a miracle. I have no idea what the teachers do to ensure the child understands. Now you are here, you can tell me. I want to tell you clearly, there is something, there is a problem on earth, and you are created to solve it. The trouble with some of us is our problems are still remaining unsolved when you are helping others to solve theirs. So you need to ask yourself, are you solving the problem you are created? Solve. Every one of us. When you talk about your life's purpose, it has absolutely nothing to do with you. Your life's purpose is not to be the richest man at 40. That's a meaningless. That's a meaningless vision. Meaningless. You need to tell me exactly what, even if you make billions, for what? For what is your purpose? Because sometimes you may need to make money in order to realize your purpose. So it's a critical thing. So I'm suggesting to you that if you are going to end up, if you are going to end up in a with a team that's going to be performing and doing well, we need to handle that topic. What is the purpose in your life? Second, once you have established, and it's a subject that may take time. Maybe I will give Mr. Karanja a few of my books if you're interested in reading on it. But the second exercise you need to do is to find out why Nairobi Academy exists. Why does it exist? What's the mission of Nairobi Academy? It cannot be just to educate. There's something they want to achieve. Only they are using the school to achieve it. Maybe the owner of the school, maybe the top leadership of the school need to answer the question. But you need to be clear. Don't write a mission statement like another school wrote. To be the best school south of the Sahara, north of the Limpopo. Now, that's a meaningless one. First of all, there may be no data to establish whether you are going to reach there. You cannot put a purpose you don't know when you achieve or when you don't achieve. You need something that you can measure. And it'll be important to find out. Because if you don't know the purpose, all of us will be pulling in different directions. We will not be a team. It's important to ask ourselves, what do we want? Don't say, I'm teaching biology. Find out, before you talk biology, find out what kind of child we want to produce and how will he behave. Because the work of this academy is not for people to pass exams. It's for people to become responsible citizens of the world. Am I right? And that's totally different. You can teach biology, pass in biology, then commit suicide. Are you getting my point? So you need to ask yourself exactly why does this school exist? Not to get more A's than other schools, because people get A's and go nowhere. In fact, when I was at Alliance, one of my classmates in Form 4, we used to do 8 subjects. I don't know whether the British system is still the same. We used to do 8 subjects, but the ones they would count are only the best 6. My friend got 8 ones. So when you asked him the best 6, he said, which one? Because all of them are ones. So it was no way of asking him the best 6. I think there are very few people when it was those days that used to get ones. There were some would get 1 and 2, because a 2 was also a distinction. But to get flat ones was rare. That guy was so good that when you are in Form 6, when you finish Form 5 in Form 6, he got an exchange program with a school in Britain. And he went there when they were remaining only 6 months to do A-level, because the A-level is in June. And we had only come in March of the year, because the results used to come out in March. And he still got his 3 principles and got admitted to university in Britain, having done almost only 1 year of a 2-year course. When he came back in September, we still had not done our exams. He was asked whether he wanted to do the Kenyan exam. He said yes. Although he has already passed, he was just joining us in. He still got his 4 A's. Now, that's how clever he is. The other day I met one of our, well, we left Alliance more than 40 years ago, but I asked one of my friends to say, where did so-and-so go? We all ask each other, we can't know where he went. He went to Britain, finished his university, came back to Kenya. Nobody knows whether he's alive or dead. You need to understand, and I'm not saying this with jest, I wish I could know exactly where he is, but I want to tell you clearly, getting A's is not the reason these two exist. And even if you get A, you are still a failure if you produce drunkards. If you produce immoral people, if you produce corrupt people, you are still failure. So you need to spend time at a school finding out what kind of a child do you intend to produce, and don't measure your success with exams, because that's only one aspect of the life of a child. A child is both the mind, the body, and the spirit. So the fact that the mind has been worked on, that's not a human being. Human being is all the three in one. And you must tell me how you are helping the other places. I was just speaking with Kathy about as we were preparing and talking about the danger of forgetting some things. For example, some of the Kenyan schools are getting so caught up in producing grades that there's no longer need for sports. And so you go through school and you have no time for sports. And as, I wish that was only in high school. They're also doing it in nursery. You know, now there are exams in nursery. I don't know what they test anyway. But they are testing people even in pre-unit. Now, with that kind of life, you produce children who cannot explore their sports ability. So if God has called them into sports, are they going to discover? And who is the problem? Nairobi Academy. Instead of being rewarded, you should be punished for spoiling people. I know the parents are pushing you for grades, but sure, you know better than the parents. Help the parents to see. So you can't just do what the parents want. The reason you are here is not for the sake of the parents, although they are ones who pay. You are here because of the children. Would you agree with me? And so you need to think in those terms. Why does this school exist? What kind of a child do you actually want to produce? And you'll discover that when that is properly discussed, your curriculum, the way the school is organized, may need to change. Because what you are doing may be aimed at one area. If that's not where you want to go, why would you continue in the same direction? Why am I emphasizing this? Because it's related with the fast. Once it's clear what purpose you exist to meet, then you discover why your employer exists. If the two are in agreement, you will never want to leave the school. Okay, getting my point? Because you feel it's like a duck in the water. You are exactly where you are created to be. But put your hand into the water, and it will be terrible, isn't it? So you need to see that once your calling, your purpose in life is in alignment with the employer's purpose, you tend to enjoy the where you are working. And so that's why I'm saying, if you really want to have teamwork, it will be important that is actually understood. I think that thing that we need to establish, if you're really going to work well, are your core values. Core values. What are core values? Core values are values that are so core, you can't live without them. That's why most consultants, and I do consultants work, I used to work for Shell. I did work for Shell for around 30 years. Then they said I was old, as young as I am. So from then onwards, I spent time advising people in leadership and management. And I keep saying, you don't need more than 6 core values. Why? Even to keep the 6 is an impossible thing. What a core value? A core value is a non-negotiable conviction. In other words, you can't negotiate it. You are so committed to it, you are willing to be fired rather than break it. And you need to find out, what are your core values as a person? What are the things that you feel like, that one, I can't do. I would rather be jobless rather than do that. And many people have no core values. Their values change with the environment. And those are difficult people to deal with. Because you live, you agree as a team this is what to do. He goes for holidays and his cousin tells him something else. He comes a different person. Because he himself has no core values. They are non-negotiable convictions. Everything is up for grabs. You're not a human being. You know something very interesting? Those of you who come from the rural areas will understand what I'm talking about. If you found a cow on heat, they are very difficult to manage. For those of you in town, just forgive me. But those of us who have grown in the rural area, you understand a cow on heat. Am I communicating?
Yes.
They are impossible to control. But you never hear anybody saying, the cow of so-and-so is very immoral. Ever heard of it? No. We don't say it's immoral. Because cows are neither immoral nor moral. They are moral. But human beings have values. Are supposed to have values. So when you do something different, we say so-and-so is immoral. Because he's supposed to have values. So for you to have no values, you will be a very difficult person to work with. Three problems. Number one, you cannot predict yourself. You don't know how you'll act tomorrow. Number two, we can't predict you. Number three, because we can't predict you, we are suspicious of you. Am I communicating? So it means it makes it very difficult to work with you. Because, for example, one moment you are saying, short boys are good. Then you discover the mother of the shortest boy in your class is very friendly to you. All of a sudden you say, tall boys are good. You say, wait a minute. Last time you told us short boys are, what happened? You have no core values. I can tell you, people with core values have a lot of friends. Because anybody predictable attracts people like honey to the bee. Nobody wants unpredictable people. It's the same thing with people who have no, they are moody. Ever heard of, it's a very dangerous thing to be told you are moody. What does moody mean? It means you are like a thermometer. You change with the temperature. Up or down. You have no fixed thing. And depending on your mood, you behave different. One of our textbooks in the 60s used to be, the beautiful ones are not yet born. I agree. Now you need to understand the book. The book talks of mood pericles, mood jackals. There are several moods, and you cannot tell somebody. Now I'm suggesting to you that when you have no core values, you are also moody. Because there's nothing to hold that. You see, when you have clarity on your core values, it means even if something is going to cost you something, you are willing to pay the price. So don't move with changes in the temperature. There is something you are committed to. There is something you can deal with. There is something you can stick with. So I'm suggesting to you, if you want to work together as a team, it will be important, number one, you establish what your core values are. 5 to 6. My suggestion is, before the term has gone very far, just spend one weekend. Do you teach on Saturdays? Yeah, so you have the time. Take a Saturday morning or a Saturday afternoon and move away from your family. And just spend the time asking yourself, what are my core values? Of course, I'm a little late for some people, but you do it. Because if you are not married and you have no core values, that will be a very important exercise. Because as soon as you meet somebody else with different core values, you know there's no need of giving him a second date. One is enough. Because you already know that guy cannot make up a team with you. Because your core values are non-negotiable. So how would you marry somebody whose values are different from yours? Now, if you're already married, I do not intend you divorce. But still do the exercise. Still do the exercise. Because once you are clear about your exercise, then you discuss them with your spouse. Say, by the way, although you have been pushing me to go this way, my real core value tells me to go this way. Then you'll agree how to accommodate one another. She now knows that's not an area I can push him. And sometimes people live together because they accommodate one another. But when people don't have clarity about your core values, they are going to make good decisions, assuming that they are good to you and they expect you to follow up. I still remember I used to work for Development Bank. Then I joined Shell in 1979. And they gave us a car with somebody else. To drive around seeing their customers. And I still remember we were in Kericho and we were seeing the tea estates. Most of the tea estates were Shell customers. Shell having been a British company, had a big market share then. And so we would see the customers, then go to sleep at the Kericho Tea Hotel. And one of the evenings, this guy who was the one driving, told me, I have friends in there, but I told them to come to meet us in Kericho Hotel. So we were there. I was a young man, assuming, see how young I am. Now look at 79, I must have been younger. So they are discussing. And I was not long from, I did a business course in the university. It was not long after my university. So my facts were there. So these old people are discussing, and I could see they don't have the facts. So I started, as young as I was, I say, with all due respect, this is the information. And they said something else, I said, with all due respect, this is the information. One guy turned around and said, what? This young man has economic certificates. You must have a task on me. Now, I don't take alcohol. And these are people, the top, the cream of Kericho town. How do you tell him you don't take alcohol? And he has already decided to ask the waiter to bring you Tasca. Have a Tasca on me. So I started scratching and sweating. Is it okay if I take a soda? He told me, no, my money is not wasted in such cheap things. That set me even more sweating, and my legs were having fellowship. Now, you need to understand. You need to understand, by the time I was able to gain courage to say, I'm a Christian, I don't take alcohol. I said, is that it? Then take your foolish thing. Why did you tell that me from the beginning? I can tell you, when people don't know you, they can put you into trouble, and they are not intending to put you into trouble. They simply don't know who you are. Am I communicating?
Yes.
So you therefore will end up not happy with the team, but the team is not to blame. It is because you don't know who you are, and if you do, you have not told them. Am I right? So it's important for you to establish, and I am encouraging you not to have more than 6. On all other values, they are negotiable. You can convince me. But on these 5 or 6, I'm not open for discussion. What are they? It will help you to work better with others when that is established. Having established your own, find out what are the core values of this organization, of Nairobi Academy. Do they have core values? Does Nairobi Academy have core values? Do you know them off head? Now the number goes down. But it's important to know them. By the way, it's not to know the name, integrity. No. It is to know the meaning of integrity. What does the word mean to Nairobi Academy? Last year, I had the privilege, which surprised me. I was actually doing some training, some leaders in Zambia, when I got an SMS from a body called SCAC. And I didn't know what it is, so I sent an SMS and said, can you email? When they emailed, I still could not understand who they are. But they were inviting me when I come for a meeting the following week. It turned out the president had ordered all parastatal boats to go through training in Mombasa. And I'd been picked as one of the consultants to help the boats know how to run ethical organizations. And so I spent from September to December, I was in Mombasa once a week when my topic used to be Wednesdays. And I was talking with many people on the issue of ethics. And I discovered definitions are different. You can be using the same word, but doesn't mean the same. So it's important to understand. Now, if you have read my book, I've told you are likely to have read something I call a worldview. What is worldview? Worldview are the glasses through which you see life. So that we can be looking at the same thing, but depending on your glasses, you see something different. For example, if I like color red, all I needed to wear red sunglasses, and all of you rotan red. If I'm tired of that, I just put those one down, and now put green. All of you rotan green. That's how life is. We can be looking at the same thing, but you are looking at different things, depending on your worldview. Worldview are the glasses through which you interpret life. I like giving an example that I thought was very interesting. When I was still working for Shell, I had one of our London office visitors, a British, come. And because I used to be operations manager, and I was taking him to a Mombasa depot, I promised to give him a treat and took him to Tamarind, one of the most expensive hotels then, I don't know about now, in Mombasa. They had a boat, you ordered as the boat was leaving, and went round part of the Indian Ocean. By the time you finish your meal, you are back, but you paid for it. So it was pretty expensive. But since I was giving entertaining, so Cheryl was paying. But what interested me is, you arrive, you are given a drink, or they ask you for which drink, or then they ask you to come and order. You don't order from a paper. You come the seafood section to see the foods available. And I went there to see what to order, and I found crabs moving. They are alive still. And snails, and I said, wait a minute, where did we come? At that moment, my British friend is watering John. How can you be so kind? You know, I can't afford this. I'm so happy. Now, I'm running away from it. He's running towards it. Now, now the question is, how come the snails, the crabs are attracting the guy, and they're making me go away? Simply, our worldview. In his worldview, only when you are well-loaded do you go to a seafood restaurant. It's for the rich. It's for a treat. For me, crabs eat people. People don't eat crabs. At any way, unless you are mad, how can you eat a snail? Surely. What will you be missing? Now, that's the way I grew up. Are you getting the difference? So you need to understand that you can be saying the same thing, but we mean different things. So as we talk about agreeing, remember you're still talking about how working together. It will be important we don't just give words. There should be one or two sentences on what it means to this school for that particular core values. You know, we have very different things. For example, and you'll forgive me if I use you as an example. Maybe let me not use it. So I'm a Kikuyu, so I'll use a Kikuyu one. So in our tradition as Kikuyus, we hated thieves, so my grandfather told me, so badly that if they caught you stealing, they would put you in a beehive, put dry leaves around it, put you on a high position going down to the river so that you die properly. They put it on fire, and you are going down, you don't die from the fire, you die from the crash, you don't die from the crash, you die from drowning. You must properly die. That's how much they hated thieves. The same people who hated thieves, when young man were of age, they knew how to prove to the girls, you are great. They went to Maasai land, stole their cows, and whoever stole most was the one that they sang about in the dances. Remember, both are stealing. When you steal from another Kikuyu, they kill you. You steal from Maasai, they sing for you. Are you getting the point? But the real thing is, both are stealing. So it's only, so don't say, so when the missionary came and he told Kikuyus, thou shalt not steal, the Bible says, Kikuyu says, we agree. Because it's true that they agreed. But their definition of stealing is stealing from somebody who is your, from your place. So when you make a Kikuyu now, the managing director of a Paracetamol, does it belong to his mother? Now, can you understand now? So, so when he takes the money and he comes and builds a house in his rural area, the bishop will come to open the house. The guy is not a thief. He never stole from others. Are you getting the point? It's exactly the same word. It's exactly the same word, but it has different meanings. So you need to understand that it's not enough to just say core values. It means different. You have people, for example, there can be a value that there must not be any sexual harassment in this academy. But you have to find out what does it mean to the school and to the people. There are some men who know when a woman says no, she means yes. Now, so when you start telling, saying you are sexually harassing, says surely, Mwalimu, unless you don't understand. When women say no, they mean
yes.
Yes. So they can't understand why you're harassing him. He has done nothing wrong. When the woman said no, she actually meant. Are you getting the point? The guy agrees that you should not sexually harass each other. But his definition is different from yours. So it's important that if we are going to work as a team, we must be agreed on what these values are and how those values can actually be aligned by defining. Even the ones I talked about, your own personal ones. Don't just use words. You must write two or three sentences explaining what that means to you. Now, let me digress a little and say, can you then see how important, especially those of you who teach kindergarten and primary school, because psychologists tell us the worldview is made before you count your years in double digits. By the time you are a teenager, you already know, you already have worldview. You already know what is right and wrong. That's why in high school, it's very difficult to deal with the boys. Even if you teach them, they know what the right thing is. They just write down to pass exams. The people who dealt with them between year 0 and 10 years are the ones who gave them the worldview. So you need to understand, and I'm not discouraging the ones in high school, but please understand, you are too late. Now, the people with the job are the kindergarten and primary school. That's when people are discovered. Because a person, before they are 10, they have not made up their mind. You can move them in a direction. By the time they are 10, even when the father tells them something, they argue with the father. Am I right? Those of you with the teenage children, am I right? They argue with you. But then when they are below 10, whatever the father says must be right. So because at that time, they have not got those fixed things. And so you need to understand, as a school, one of your biggest jobs before high school is to help them to get the right worldview with which they will interpret life. In high school, it's a time to ask questions. So the biggest job of the high school teacher is to answer the question honestly and clearly. Because they are trying to verify their worldview. That's why they sound rude. But they're not rude. When you feel we are dealing with teenagers, the trouble normally is the older person, not the teenager. Because the teenager is just questioning. That is his age. He has not stabilized. Who is a teenager? A teenager is a person who is too old to be a child and too young to be an adult. Are you getting the point? They are not sure where. You tell a teenager, why are you behaving like a child? But I'm a child. Then you ask him, can't you do something? Now he said, but I'm an adult. Now, exactly who are you? That's why it's very difficult to manage teenagers. Because they are in a questioning mood. And when you have a good teacher who understands the questions are not rudeness, that you can't expect a teenager to behave like a 10-year-old, you are going to help them and facilitate them. That was the digression. Back to our theme. And it's important then to understand that once your core values and the core values organization don't agree, don't resign now, but plan to resign. you are not going to enjoy the team because they are totally in disagreement with your core values. And your core values are so core, you will always be uncomfortable. You will be here only for the salary, but you really are looking forward to moving somewhere else. So it's important to ask, what are those and how are you dealing with it? I know I want to allow question time, and I was told to have all the time, but I would have really wanted to be through before your stomach rings the bell. But let me just tell you, seated here are several types of people. And I like giving, and I'm talking about motivation in their work, I'm like giving the story of this man who went visiting some builders who are building a cathedral. I discovered that in Europe, one of the tourist sites, they don't have our Masai Mara. So the tourist sites are old buildings, still remember being in Finland. And the share staff over the weekend drove me 50 kilometers just to see an old building. They said, John, this was built 1520. Now, it's neither here nor there. But you need to understand, cathedrals were made for those, the best architects of each country during the Middle Ages were always people building cathedrals. Why? All kings used to report to the Pope. And so when you build a cathedral, it will show you and get you respect from the Pope. So the cathedrals of that age is the best building. So here is somebody visiting a cathedral construction site. And he finds somebody laying bricks, a mason, laying bricks. And he's putting one stone, picking it on, putting another. He said, by the way, what are you doing? And he said, I'm laying bricks. Oh, I see. Now, if somebody tells you he is laying bricks, does it sound romantic? Just putting one stone on top of her and doing it. Though some of those construction will take 10 years of continually doing it. Some of us are in this school, but we are bricklayers. What do you do? I teach biology. Really? If you can't see something beyond teaching biology, it's a mechanical thing. And anyway, the trouble with you, and I sympathize with you, my wife is a lecturer as well, and she has been marking they are just about to open, she has been marking. And so she says one of the most difficult things in marking is you ask one question for 100 people to answer. And if they are good, they all repeat the same thing. Now, so it's very boring to mark. Now, I don't know that it is true of you. But if the only thing that brings you to this school is to teach, there's nothing else. And you are teaching biology for 10 years. And the syllabus has not changed. I'm starting to get my drift. You have to pull your leg out of your bed every morning. Why am I going? Repeating my amoeba. But I told amoeba for 20 years. I've been repeating the word? Amoeba. Are you getting the point? No motivation to wake up. And that's the way that bricklayer was. He was on site just to put one stone on top of another. And you could see it from the face. He is not very encouraged by what he is doing. The visitor, the tourist, went to another corner, cathedrals are very big, went to another corner and found another bricklayer. Although he was doing exactly the same, he asked the same question. What are you doing? The guy stopped, straightened up, and he said, I am building a cathedral. And he was smiling. Between the first and the second, who is motivated? Why? He doesn't see the stone. He sees a completed cathedral. And then he pictures himself as a grandfather, like me, telling the grandchildren. Do you remember the biggest building in this nation? Because there used to be only one cathedral per country. I was one of the people who built it. Can you see the pride? Although he's constructing, he is thinking of the future and seeing himself telling his grandchildren how he built the cathedral and is getting excited about it. So every morning he wakes up, he realizes it's still dark. He says, what's wrong with me? Why is there no light? He is looking forward to going back to making history. Although the truth is, the two people are doing exactly the same thing,
The second one is not bothered about just the stone. It's thinking about the cathedral and the kind of magnificent cathedral it will be and the fact that it will be making history. Let me ask you, as you come to this school, are you a bricklayer or a builder of cathedral? Do you see that child the way they are or the way they will be? What do you see? Do you look at your class and imagine the future Uhuru, the future Matiang'i? Is your standard 2 child? Am I communicating? Do you see them the way they are or the way they can be? The choice is yours. Look at that boy with the makamasi coming from every direction and speaking English in Chinese. But you start getting discouraged when you look at him as a future president. When you're a grandmother, you'll be saying, "You see that president? He was in my class." Forgive his English. I'm the one who taught him. Now, you need to understand. You need to understand that you got that class and you already are at it. And you know, I speak a lot, at least for the last 40 years, I've been giving these kind of talks in the universities. And sometimes I get to feel like I've done it for so long that that is not interesting. And then I meet somebody. And he says, in fact, I got an SMS this, says, the person, although I still haven't discovered who the person is reminding what I told them. Somebody will tell me exactly, I started speaking at the university around 1977. That's the first time I was invited by the university. Those days I was only one university. And they can remind me exactly what I said in 1977. And they start telling me exactly what has changed. The other day, a professor friend of mine reminded me how when he left university in the 80s, I was talking to him as a young man, and I told him about the difference between renting a house and a mortgage. And he told me, he can still remember, that I told him a mortgage is a bottomless pit, but a rent is a bottomless pit, because you keep throwing money in somebody's pocket. When you want to move out of the house, he simply tells you thank you and gets another tenant. Am I right? So it's like you are throwing money in a hole that never fills up. A mortgage is also a very deep pit, but it has a bottom. So as you keep throwing money, you can't even see where they are going, but it's growing up. If in 5 years you are unable to pay your mortgage, you just sell the house. The value has risen. Get your money out, pay back the bank, and you go rich. Is that true? So when you have a choice, all of us must stay in the house. The choice is, do you throw it in a bottomless pit or in through another pit with a bottom? Because a mortgage house is near to your house. It's a house that could be yours. It's not yet yours. But the good thing is, the appreciation of the asset, the capital appreciation, goes to your pocket, not to their mortgager's pocket. Now, when he says, I can't remember saying that. That is more than 25 years ago. But he says, I want you to take you to see the house I built. He took me, we took lunch with my wife, and he said, I just wanted you to know that the things you told me, and you can't even remember telling me, that's what, it has haunted me all the years. I couldn't stay longer in a rented house. What do you think I felt? Now, can you start feeling it now? Am I communicating? Don't wait to feel it then. Feel it now. That as I'm working on these children, in another quarter of a century, they are the top class in this town. You know, you need to understand what are, at least those of us in our 60s, you look back and you are, you know, in the 70s, when I went to hospital, the doctors were always older than me. Then somewhere in the 80s, they were my age. Now, every time I go to a doctor, and they are telling me to roll out my trouser to do what they do, I look at the boy, and I wonder, will I really show him my nakedness? Now, because he's a child, but he's still a doctor. Am I communicating? Are you aware, teachers, that within no time, this 32 child will be telling you, please lower your trouser. Are you getting the point? So if you treated him badly when he was a student, it will depend on how you put in the needle. So, but the trouble with a lot of us is we see the 32 child as they are now, rather than what they will be. Am I communicating? So if you want to really enjoy your work, it will be important to see the cathedral rather than the laying of the bricks. And so you need to see that child in terms of what are they, where are they, how are they going to be in future? Look at their potential, not their performance now. Are we together? But the guy had not finished. The tourist went on. He went to another corner. And he asked a bricklayer still, asked him, what are you doing? The guy straightened up, started smiling, surveyed the visitor, and said, you really want to know? I am busy depopulating hell and filling heaven. I said, what did you say? You know, when this cathedral is full, it will give the bishop a chance to talk to the people that will flock to this building. Many of them will be flocking here, simply because they want to be in a good building. But when the preacher preaches to them, they will stop their drunken ways, change, and people going to heaven rather than going to hell. And that is only possible because of my work. Number one, bricklayer. Number two, beautiful cathedral. Number three, depopulating hell and populating heaven. In other words, he is simply a black layer, but he sees himself as an evangelist. Because without him, the bishop can't do what he needs to do. Am I communicating? Now, let me ask you. You see, the first category is a guy there just to make money. I want to educate my children. What can I do? The second one, it has now changed to see what he is doing and its impact. The third one, not only sees the impact, but sees it as serving God. The first one is serving himself. The second one is serving the community. The third one is serving God. Are we seeing the difference? So you need to ask yourself, which of the three categories are you involved in? We may all be in Nairobi Academy, but the motivational levels will depend on which bricklayer you are. That makes a lot of difference. There was a time I was district manager for Shell for many years, and because the top management has only 5 people, when you reach middle management, it's very difficult to get a promotion. And I still remember somebody coming to my office and says, hey, Nganga, you work so hard, but they have not promoted you for a number of years, and you still work like a donkey. I said, I don't work for a promotion. I work to see the way my job has impact. Shell, it was then the biggest oil company in Kenya. To imagine that nobody in any corner of Kenya will not receive fuel because I have set up distribution systems that ensure every petrol station has the product was my aim. I went everywhere and realized what we are doing is keeping. Now, by the time I retired, I had reached top management. And so there was somebody reporting to me who was in my previous job. But I still remember I retired 07. That's when I became 55. And I still remember as I was about to retire, the country started fighting just when I'm retiring. And the CEO asked me, said, no, we can't allow you to go. You must help us out of the crisis. You know, the day the fighting started, people realized the easiest thing to use is petrol. So they started burning petrol stations. They started burning tankers or using them in order to do damage. So my transporters withdrew their vehicles. Within no time, Uganda was without any fuel. We tried to move the fuel by rail, and in Kibera, they went and uprooted the rail line. Those who are older will remember, will you? That was now my job, to see how Uganda can continue getting fuel, and Western Kenya can continue getting fuel.
through the crisis.
As I rang the depot manager during the in the middle of the crisis for Nairobi Terminal to ask him, since the fuel was still coming by pipeline, to ask him, we must load. And he was on Thika Road. He told me, but Mr. Nganga, I can't reach the depot. They'll kill me. I said, but you know, as we talk, people are going into Nairobi, Kenyatta Hospital with arrows. And because the boilers are not working, the theaters are affected. People are dying who don't need to die unless the boiler fuel can be made available. I know you are taking a risk, but now it's nothing to do with the money. Just think of the people who are dying. And we agreed, because by that time we had mobiles. We agreed, he takes off on Thika Road, passes through Museum Hill, and follows Mombasa Road to see whether he can bypass the Mathare section that was very dangerous, and then approach the depot on Udanyi Road from General Motors. So he kept telling me, now I've reached here. He goes again, sees trouble, he stops, he rings me, until finally he found in the depot. Then he said, you know, I'm in the depot, but you know, I need staff. The next job was to try to get some people willing to come to open the valves. The third thing was to get transporters. It had nothing to do with work or getting money. No transporter. You see, if they ban your vehicle, if they ban your vehicle during a riot, it's not covered by insurance. You're aware. So they can't agree. My appeal was, we are not working. We are serving God. We cannot allow people to die when there is something we can do. A few transporters finally gave us vehicles. And Shell was the first company to land fuel in Uganda, in Kisumu, and in Eldoret. I was not doing it for money. Nothing to do with money. I recognized my job was no longer to build a cathedral. It was to depopulate heaven, to depopulate hell, and populate heaven. You need to start seeing your job as not simply, you know, simply building a cathedral. How is your job in service of God? That will make all the difference. And I finish with this. When you don't have clarity about your job, you will still earn your salary, I promise you. But you are going to end up in trouble. When you do something you don't enjoy, it's a duty. It can be terrible. Now, you know, it's very interesting. There are guys in Britain, because that's where they have good money, who are paid a lot of money to play football. Am I right? So when he is going to work, he feels, oh, can't we have a holiday? Coach, give us a holiday. Yet there are people here, when they want to rest, they play football. Same game. You hit the ball or catch it. Same game. One goes to rest, the other goes to work. You see, the guy going to work sees it as hard work. The guy going to whose football is hobby just goes there to enjoy it. Am I right? It is your choice. You can come to this academy to enjoy or to endure. The two words sound similar, isn't it? Enjoy or endure. Those of you without clarity as to why you are here, you earn your salary, but you endure it. As you endure, you go in the evening and you can't even sleep, wondering when you leave this place. Those who enjoy go every evening and sleep like babies. They feel like the contribution I made today, even if I don't ever teach again, thank you, God, for the privilege. So you, when you go to sleep, you don't count stars, assume you can see them. You simply go to sleep. You wake up in a rush to come back. You enjoy. If you are enduring, you soon suffer from stomach ulcers. And you know, I was asking a doctor what is psychosomatic disease. And he said psychosomatic diseases are diseases that come from thinking. I said, what do you mean? Out of your stress and thoughts and whatnot, the body reacts. I said, and you get properly sick, and there's no virus, no germ, no. He explained, you don't need a virus or a germ, just your thoughts. Your body still becomes so disorganized. It starts excreting a substance when there is no food to chew. It starts chewing itself. It starts chewing your stomach. You go to the toilet, you produce blood. Yet there was no germ and no virus. What is coming from? Your work. Work is killing many people. You are always seeing the doctor, high blood pressure, ulcers, whatnot. There's nothing that you sorted out because it is inside you. It is you to look at life differently. And you start enjoying what you have been enduring. Thank you very much. We allow questions or comments because I may have been scratching where it is not itching. Have somebody ever tried to scratch you and they are not getting where there is an itch? It actually is painful, am I right? But when finally they reach where exactly where the itch is, you say, on your go. No, you just use so nice. So I may be scratching where it is not itchy. So it's more important that you ask questions, because then I'm likely to start scratching exactly where it is itching. I defined what the issues are we are covering, and some of them I have not been able to cover, but the time I had allocated is up. It's still of that already. So let's spend the few minutes remaining just dealing with whatever issues come up. Can be a comment. Is there something I said which you think was useful to you and others? If you repeat it in your own words, you are likely to be better understood than I was. But there's something I said and you don't agree with it. I think even if we disagree, let's agree what we disagree about. Are we together? So just tell me what you disagree with so that at least I know. But thirdly, it's a point of clarification. You simply don't understand what I meant. And I think it may be good to just ask the question. Oh, sorry, there are hands already.
So, if you find yourself in the wrong place, doing the wrong thing, what is the strategy?
I'm sure the headmaster will not want me to answer that question. Now, let me tell you, if you truly have done what I've described, and you identify what you are doing here should not appear in your 80th birthday, that's not what you want to be. Please understand, you don't have a lot of time to waste. However, you must put food on the table. Are we together? So you need to start giving yourself, the next 1 year, I want to be somewhere else. In order to be. So once you have identified the need in the world you want to deal with, the next thing to do is to look at your own giftings. What are your giftings? For example, maybe your basic calling in life is to alleviate suffering. But suffering can be alleviated in ways. Now, if you forgot to do biology in Form 2, now you can't be wanting to be a doctor. It's too late. Are we together? But there are other things you could do. For example, maybe reorganizing the community so that they are better they look after themselves nutritionally better. It will reduce the number of people who go to hospital, isn't it? So instead of going to treating the diseases, you go to preventing diseases. That is now dependent on the gifts God has given you. You can have the same calling, two of us, but you approach it from different angles because our approach will depend on our gifting. Are we together? So that's what you need to analyze. What are you gifting? Again, if you pick my book, that book, and read the chapter on how to discover your life's purpose, I make several suggestions. And once it's clear, give yourself time. Don't jump out. Yeah. First of all, arrange how to jump out. Are we together? Be stylistic in the way you jump out. Don't just jump out. So you start preparing. You might have to do an evening course. You might, in order to fit into an area, you might need to continue teaching and doing an evening course as a way of preparing. But don't stay too long in the wrong thing. And I told you the reason why it's wrong. Number one, you are doing somebody else's work, not yours. Because there is somebody called to do that. So why do somebody else's work when yours still remains undone. Number two, whenever you work within your calling, you tend to be good at it. Because remember the three bricklayers, isn't it? The guy who feels he's doing serving God will wake up early and will not leave on time. He will leave after time. There's some commitment. So people who operate within their calling end up doing better. The trouble in the first category is that because you are not committed to it, you are only doing the basic minimum, you don't get a promotion. Now, because you are not promoted, you are even feeling worse. But how could you be promoted when you are not even committed? Am I communicating? So you suffer double. You suffer because you are doing the wrong thing, then you suffer because you never progress in something you don't have a call. Thirdly, when you work within your calling, you tend to enjoy it. It may be tough, but you enjoy it. The other day I was with somebody I was speaking in a church, and somebody said, hey, you know, people call me Brother Nga. Brother Nga, you know, I always take your cassettes and send them to my husband in Afghanistan. I said, what? Your husband works in Afghanistan? Yes, he works there, but he comes every 6 weeks. I said, why would anybody volunteer to go to Afghanistan? You know, at that time, the bullets were flying. We always saw on the TV people dying. So I couldn't see anybody who is not a soldier wanting to work there. You know, I was so impressed by that thing that the next time I was speaking somewhere else, I gave the example of that guy. When you are within your calling, the bullets don't frighten you. Only to go outside, and the lady now came to greet me. And he told me, this is the man you are talking about. I was very embarrassed because I didn't know the person is in the church. That's what I meant. That's why I said, it's what I was saying, right? Yes, I am sure I'm doing what God wants me to do. I enjoy, as the bullets fly, I know God is controlling me. And so I come and enjoy what I'm doing. You see, he is doing a dangerous job, but he's not enduring it. He is enjoying it. So you need to understand that when you do something you feel a call for, somehow you enjoy your life. And you don't have two lives to lead. To do something that you feel you are in the wrong place is not something you should sustain. So I hope I've answered your question.
You have. So now we have a mix of all of us. Some who want to be here, some who don't want to be here, and we have to work as a team.
Yeah. Now, once somebody admits where they are, then they'll understand that they're only helping others. Am I communicating?
Yes.
You are not within your area. You are just helping. With that understanding, you can work well in a team. The trouble is when you want to be promoted in the wrong thing. Am I communicating? And getting frustrated that they are promoted ahead of you. But you say, no, this is not where I want to be. You promote Wanjiro, it's okay. I'm moving out. So when Wanjiro is promoted, do you feel jealous? No, it's not your area. So you can work as a team.
Yeah.
Anybody else with a comment? Yes?
It's just a comment. I think, in my opinion, this talk you've given was an absolutely brilliant analogy of not just the teaching work area, but of most work areas. I just want to say thank you.
Okay. Yeah, certainly it's not about teaching. I was only giving an example of teaching because I'm full of teachers in the room. Yeah, you are right. Anybody else with a question, a comment? Yes?
I think it's a comment and a question as well.
Yes.
Parenting is one of those professions where you don't get trained. You learn on the job.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, life seems to be the same. And I'm personally of the opinion that in life we have stages. Just like the facial expressions of a child will change,
yeah,
so do our needs and therefore core values change according to our ages and time in life. Is it possible that your core values would change whether you're a teenager, whether you're in midlife, or whether you are in your old age?
That's why we agreed we must define what our core values. Because a core value is something you live for. It will not change with life. But how you do it will change. I can't do what I used to do in my 20s. But my values are the same. If you hate immorality, age will not change you. You still hate immorality. That's a value. So we need to be careful. We are not talking about interest. Interest change with the time. Values remain the same. And I know you mean, I'm guessing you mean interest. They certainly will change from time to time. Values are things that help you to see, why do you do what you do? The answer to the question, not what you do, but the answer to the question, the value that's driving you, that doesn't change. But what you do will change. Because there are things you can't do, and your interests will change. Like, example, you can be playing football when you are younger. Then, when you are older, you play volleyball. Assuming volleyball is easier. Now, but if you hate, if you don't like hurting others, you'll be careful how you play volleyball. The same way you are careful how you played football. The idea of not hurting others is a value. And it doesn't change with age.
And on to the question. You've told us that before they get into teenage, it might be easier to shape them. Some of us are dealing with those ones who are at times looked at as being rebellious when they're just trying to find themselves. Now, at that point in their lives, how can you influence them without trying to make them become you? You know, it is said that adults always seem to want the children to live their lives the way they would have wanted to live them. So how can you avoid that danger of trying to make me yourself among the students and maybe guide them so that they find their own values and not necessarily your values? Because there's the danger of indoctrination rather than...
reproducing yourself.
Yes, rather than letting them find themselves.
Three things. Number one, you need to understand none of us has similar purpose. Every one of us has a different purpose. And there lies the big problem. Because many fathers assume their children are them. And true, your child cannot be you, sister. Why? The father's genes are also there, isn't it? Even if you don't like it. It's important to understand. It's important to understand that your child is not you. So why, when you try to produce him to be you, you are lying to yourself. He has different genes. What even makes it more complicated is that they talk about recessive genes. So some genes that never came out of you, but were in your mother, have now appeared in your son. Okay, see the difference? So you need to understand all of us. That one of the things that impresses me is the idea of a dam. Everywhere I go, they tell you put that dam in. I was in Pakistan, they told me put a dam. Oh, you're okay. Now, I say, surely, there are 7 billion people with dams. 10 each. How many fingers are there? Do you know, according to them, there is nobody with my thumb out of the 7 billion people. We are so unique that God does not have to repeat your thumb mark to be like mine. So I want to emphasize, the first thing you need to realize, and I'm supporting your point, is that no child is like the parents. And if they are not like the parents, are they likely to be like the teacher? No. So it's important to understand. If you start with that in mind, then the second point comes in. One of the verses in the Bible, in case you're a Christian, talks about bring up a child the way they should go. Not the way you want them to go, the way they were created to go. The work of parents is to assist the child to discover their life's purpose and assist them to go there. It is the children don't go. And there's another verse also, we are Christians, you can check it up. That is Acts chapter 13, verse 16, talking about King David in the Old Testament. And says, David lived to fulfill God's purpose. Not his purpose, not Jesse. Jesse was the father of David. So you are not born to fulfill your father's purpose. You are born to fulfill God's purpose. In other words, there's a reason you are born. So the first thing is understand he is different. Second one is know he has a purpose. Your job as a teacher, your job as a parent is to help him to discover his purpose. If he actually becomes like you, it will be a wasted life. Because he cannot be, you know, there are three problems. Number one, he can't be you. You already said that. Number two, if he tries to be you, he cannot be as good as you. Are we together? Number three, his place will be still empty. What he was supposed to be will still be undone. Are we together? So it means, and that's a good point Mwalimu has brought, it will mean that then the parents, the teacher, has to keep asking, what do I see in this boy? and you don't tell him. You ask him questions. You know, I'm one of the people, and here I'm controversial on this one. I believe there is child molestation. When you ask another child, what do you want to become? The child says, I want to be Ben Carson. You ever heard of Ben Carson? I want to be a neurosurgeon. Ask that child, what is neuro? Leave alone surgeon. He has no idea. It's a parent talking to the child. That is child colonization, mental colonization. You know, you need to give people facts before you ask them to make decisions. So if you're in primary school, do you have enough information? No. If you came to my school, I started school in 1958. If you came to my primary school, 58, 59, and you asked me, young boy, what did you like to become? Would you like to know what I wanted to become? A tractor driver. You need to understand, the most technical person in our village was the one who drove. So I also wanted to be. Now you need to understand that we should discourage children making decisions at a very early age. Not because, and you can't prevent him thinking, but don't be the one forcing him to. Am I communicating? Don't make, what do you see? You see yourself what? I see myself as Uhuru. At the age of 6, 7 years, within no time his interests will change. Am I right? Is that the point you are making? Interests change. So it's important to understand that your job is not to tell the child who they will become, because even you may not know. For about a number of years, 6 years, I used to work for Shell in the region. I used to look after 10 countries in logistics in Africa, from Madagascar, Mauritius, this region to Ethiopia, Djibouti. So I was traveling these 10 countries. And I still remember one day coming into Hilton at Addis Ababa, and there was a bookstore. You know, somebody was selling books. And I found a book. The book was The Greatest Minds in Their Primary School Days. In other words, the school is talking about great men, and the writer has gone back to their primary school to pick what the teacher said about them. It's like a small book with a lot of famous men. The one that really interested me was Churchill, Winston Churchill. They went to his high school and his primary school, and the reports of the teachers are written there. All of them were in agreement. This boy too playful will amount to nothing. and they were consistent. It's not, in other words, he was so cheeky, it was clear, and he was not mental. You know, he didn't look, you'll go anywhere. But now you know that Churchill is one of the greatest prime ministers of not a small Britain, the Great Britain. When they used to say, it's an empire where the sun never sets. Not now, when they are just a small country. And he is credited to be one person who removed us from what was going to happen to us under Hitler. Yet, in primary school, the teacher saw him going nowhere. And you know the teachers were not lying. No, that's what they could see. Mm-hmm. So I'm not blaming the teacher. I'm only telling them they forgot their limitation. Am I communicating? You can say the child now is not doing well. You can't say you never do. Well, you don't know. Why don't you admit? You simply don't know. Tell the parent what you see now. Because you're not lying. It's true. But don't tell him about the future. So that's the second point, that you need to understand, help the child with the knowledge that his interest, his calling is different. So you don't. Thirdly, which will be very important if you're helping the child along, expose the child to many things. One of the things I hope you still do was getting biographical books and giving them as assignments. If you want somebody to learn English, give him biography. Let him read a biography of an engineer, a biography of an architect, a biography. By the time they are in, they are 13, 14 years, they have seen all these lives. Are we together? So you expose him. You don't decide for him. And you don't expose him to one thing, like this parent who wants a child to be a neurosurgeon. So when he looks at the cows, no, these are cows. Look at people. Now, how do you know he doesn't want to be a vet? Am I communicating?
Yeah.
So you allow him to explore everywhere. And that will suddenly... Have I answered your question? Okay. Who wants to be the last? Okay. You have the privilege of being the last.
Mine is a comment.
Yes.
Not far really from what you have indicated. And you, one thing that I realized, and which I think we all appreciate, is the fact that it's rare to land just once where you think you fit. Like you say, from college, you found a job and say, now I think this is my calling. Usually there are paths you go and you find a place where you think, no, this is really not really my calling. But according to my opinion, what I see, which is in rather in line with what you've said, unless you do well in that place that is not your calling, then it's very rare for you. It will be possible for you to go really where your calling is, because in most cases your promotion, your graduation to that particular place that you think you ought to be may depend on what really you're doing, where you think you're not. It's not really your calling.
Yeah, I didn't go into that subject about performance measurement, which I ran out of time. And I want to say three things about performance management. Number one, you cannot say you have performed well if you never set out to do anything. Aim at nothing and you are sure to hit it. Am I right? If you're aiming at nothing, can you miss it? No. So performance management means even if I'm in the wrong job, this is what I hope I want to achieve during this year. This is what to achieve during this term. It's important that in performance management, the critical thing is to agree what you want to achieve. That's step number one. Step number two, and I normally help organizations set up performance management systems. The second thing you must agree is, how will you measure that performance? How will you know you have achieved? You know, we can all agree we are going to be good teachers. That's a good aim. But it's not measurable. Am I right? That's why people end up using only results. Whoever had more A's is a better teacher. Is that necessarily true?
No.
No. So you need to agree how to measure. And until there are clear performance measures, performance is a meaningless thing, difficult to hit. So you must agree. How do you measure? You have agreed what your goals are. How do you measure how close you are to those goals? Now, number three, that agreement must be with the supervisor and the supervised. The supervisor cannot determine, and then he keeps it as a secret too. When finally at the end of the time you're saying I've achieved, says, no, look at my measure. You have not yet achieved anything. So that has to be agreed, not at the end, but at the beginning. So the two of you must agree in this job, this is what I intend to achieve. And both of you agree. Number two, you have to agree, this is the way we shall measure it. Then thirdly, becomes very easy. There must be periodic measures. Don't wait until the end of the year and fire someone. You need quarterly or monthly appraisals. Not at what the boss thinks. Because now, once you have agreed measures, the boss is helpless. Once you agree, the way to measure it is like this. Then along the way, the boss is annoyed with you. He would like to change the measure. Can he? No. So it will mean, and that's sometimes very embarrassing, because the guy who to you wants should be fired ends up to be the one getting the bonus. Am I right? Because you agreed the measures, now you can't change them. And the fact that he annoyed you is not part of the measure. Are you getting the point? So you have a problem. So I keep telling people, wherever you work, insist on performance management system, because it disempowers the boss and puts power in you. But on the boss's side, it makes his work easy. When he says, I'm firing you, you ask when. Because you know you should be fired. Am I communicating? There's no debate about it. You even know you also failed. Because you are the one who agreed how to measure, and you know you never met the objective. Am I communicating? It becomes very easy for the supervisor once that is done. So without the performance management system, you are at the mercy of crying babies. You know, there are people who are not performing and always crying. So give them a bonus to make them stop crying. Now, you need to agree a system where meritocracy is promoted. Are we together? And without a clear performance management system, there will be a problem. Now, even if what you are doing, you are only there for a year before you move on, you need to understand in that 1 year, you have agreed certain things, isn't it? And one of your values may be hard work. If hard work is your value, then even if you are doing something you don't enjoy, you still do hard work. So it's not a question of whether you are within your line or not. You must perform whatever you do. You do not want to be a thief of time. I've written a book called Integrity, and I keep saying the biggest thing stolen is not money. Time is stolen. Because if you are paid for 8 hours work, and four of those you are calling your friends, you certainly need to go to HR and say, this month, don't pay me everything. I don't want to be a thief. Just pay me 50% of my salary. Because I did 50% of work. If you pay me 100, I'll go to hell. And I don't want to go to hell. Take back your money. Now, you need to understand, you cannot agree on the contract to do certain work, to earn certain money, then you continue earning the same money for doing less work. Then your new title will be a thief. Am I communicating? Yeah. So if you don't want to be a thief, you must do what you are paid to do. Whether you enjoy it or not. However, I'm aware, since you are pushing yourself, it will not be enjoyable. That's why I'm saying long-term movers. But before then, don't be a thief. Earn your money. We agree this is the last one, so I'll not ask whether there's another one. And I know you want to go for lunch. So let's leave it there. And thank you very much for calling me.
All the best of a beautiful year.